So I wanted to share with you probably the most important thing I will ever tell you, and that's my personal testimony to Jesus Christ. So why am I a Christian? The simple answer is because I am just compelled by my existence and the whole world around me to believe in God, and I choose the Christian God, Yahweh, because the Bible seems to me to fit most accurately with the tangible world that I see around me. I see sin and death and pain in this world, and more importantly, I see it in myself. If there is a holy, pure, omnipotent God, it only makes sense to me that he would want to rid his creation of all this evil. The Bible tells the story of Jesus dying on the cross for my sins and then raising from the dead to conquer sin and death. So my story has a lot of ups and downs. So it's kind of like G.K. Chesterton's Intro to Orthodoxy, where he talks about trying to find a heresy in his own beliefs and then realizing in the end what he really believed was orthodoxy. And my story is kind of like that. Like I tried to go and find truth and realized I kind of started up with truth in the first place. I was born in 1979 to really devout Christian parents who taught me about Jesus at an early age. And my mom, during bedtime prayers one night, prayed the prayer to receive Jesus into my heart one night. At that age, I didn't really like struggle with the tough questions of Christianity. I kind of saw Jesus like the ultimate superhero. I think it was in my preteen years when my dad started doing what he called Bible time on Saturday mornings. He would take me and my brother and just read the scripture together and then have us ask questions and then talk about the meaning of it and then finish up in prayer. Those times I really grew in my relationship with Jesus and in my knowledge of scripture. When I was in high school, a group from Kansas came and joined my youth group, and it was during that summer that I really remember taking my faith as my own. I had a choice whether or not I wanted to go to church, and I chose to go. I have to admit, like, a lot of the draw was the youth group who had become my closest circle of friends. But I do remember thinking that Christ was the answer for the world, and I wanted to share that somehow. The first real challenge to my faith came from chat rooms online. My interest in Christian music led me to Contemporary Christian Music magazine and their chat rooms, which is all about Christian music, but there used to be these atheists that would come in and like ask all these questions. These days I think we would call those trolls. But they would actually pose some like really deep questions about life and theology and stuff, and I felt like all the Christians in the chat room would just give stupid answers, silly, shallow answers, and sometimes even gang up on the atheist. And I did not want to be one of those Christians. And some of their questions, I really started to think they had a point. These questions followed me into college and became like nagging doubts. My faith was academically and logically challenged in college in the classes I took in biology and earth science and even in English. I really began to question my faith. I wondered if maybe Christianity was based on myths and wishful thinking and just perpetuated by people who just wanted it to be true over the centuries. Maybe it was as cold as it sounded, everything really was just chance organization of molecules, and the only reason it seemed remarkable was because maybe that's evolutionarily advantageous. Because of my doubts, it was a lot easier for me to fall into a group of friends in college that just wanted to party and get drunk and have sex on the weekends. That year, I can't remember how many times I got drunk, and I even tried smoking weed on a few occasions. That first year of college, though, God really started to point out the holes in those evolutionary and atheistic arguments. I was still arguing in chat rooms, and I was starting to kind of feel myself pulled to the nihilism that comes from believing in a godless universe. But then I started to see inconsistencies in the evolutionary argument from my professors. One time, a guest lecturer showed up in my earth science class, and he was showing photos of a trip he took down the Grand Canyon. And one of his slides, he pointed out a rock wall where you could see striations where they date the layers of rock. And he stopped and he goes, "As you can see here, there's about a million, I think he said million, maybe billion years of missing geologic material." See, one of the biggest things that atheists point out with the Bible is that it can't be true because it seems to show a young earth and, the silliness of stories like Noah's flood and things. But here was a proponent of evolution who seemed to be mystified by the empirical evidence of a younger earth. Later in Biology 101, I remember my professor always saying, turn to page so and so in your textbooks, and we're going to see a picture of a creature that's amazingly been in stasis for millions of years. And so we opened up, and there was like a picture of the horseshoe crab fossil that was like 4.5 million years old. And I thought, okay, cool. Like you always show me these pictures of creatures in stasis, like actual photos. But nowhere in the whole textbook do I ever see pictures of transitional forms in the fossil layers. In fact, over millions of years, shouldn't there be a lot more of the transitional forms than present-day creatures? Another day, I was in the shower in my dorms, and I remember asking God, like, God, if you're really there, why can't you just come before me and show me, tell me audibly, if you're really the most important thing in the universe, why is there even a question as to whether you're real? And I feel like God gave me a vision. Like, I was walking down a cave. His light was showing from around the corner of the next bin. And when I got to that corner, I looked further, and the light was down the next corner. And I feel like what he was trying to show me to that was that he will show his glory, show evidence of himself in this world, and he wants me to follow that to him. He wants me to trust him. He wants me to see his glory and then choose him. Throughout the rest of my college years, I became more and more of a reader, and I was most intensely interested in creation science books. See my suggested reading list in the description below. From a scientific stance, these books did a lot to bolster my faith and show me that empirical evidence actually backs up the Bible more than actually any book ever written. The writings of C.S. Lewis, G.K. Chesterton, Lee Strobel, Josh McDowell, John Ankerberg, Ravi Zacharias, Francis Schaeffer, and Soren Kierkegaard did a lot to satisfy my growing philosophically curious mind. I really knew I was getting a lot more involved in the apologetics and stuff when our church's youth pastor asked me to speak to our youth group about creation versus evolution. So later, I felt like it was a little intellectually dishonest of me to pick a belief and only read everything that supports what I already believe. So I actually read Darwin's Origin of Species, and I read God Is Not Great by Christopher Hitchens, who's a really well-known atheist. I did reviews of those books, so you'll see why they didn't change my mind, and I'll put links in the description below. At some point, I realized not too long ago that as fascinating as apologetics are, really good arguments never really change people's mind to Christ. It's Christ who changes people. And so people really just need Jesus. After wrestling with all these deep questions, I think if the living, breathing world around me isn't enough proof that God is there, then nothing's going to prove it to me or anyone else. One day I heard Pastor Andy Stanley say something along the lines of, who among us has to know everything about a plane and how it works to before we trust enough to get on the plane? Nobody. Like, we all get on a plane without having to know how it works. And this helped me like really realize that I'm never going to be able to address every question ever against Christianity. I'm just going to have to trust one day. I also kind of realized that the reason I was trying to shut down every question against Christianity was more to prove it to myself than anyone else. The Bible says that Abraham's faith was credited to him as righteousness. Again, it just seems like to me, God, what he wants most out of us is for us to use our free will to choose him, to have faith in him. In those years of taking a hard look at my faith, I often wondered if my 4-year-old self really understood enough to be a Christian. And then I'm reminded of Matthew 18:3, where Jesus says, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." I truly believe the way to God is simple enough for a child or a simple-minded person, but at the same time, God's ways are unsearchable and answer the deepest questions we could have. A lot of people's testimonies are really drastic. Like, they're testimonies of people coming out of drugs or the occult or Satanism and then coming to know Jesus. I love these testimonies because they show the power of Christ to reach into any situation and pull people out. for me, the contrast isn't so stark. I've believed since I was a kid. And so I really think Satan has used that to blind me to what Christ has done and is doing in my life. When I really start to examine my life, I see how it's all been God. Like the fruits of the Spirit listed in Galatians 5:22, love. God has taught me how to love not just my friends and family, but unlovable people. Also to love people that hate me and hate Christianity. Joy. God has given me a deep sense of joy, which is different than like the happiness you get when your team wins or you get to go to the beach on vacation. It's more like a deep-seated joy that transcends all the anxiety and worry of life. Patience. This one's kind of hard. Like I'm not always patient, but I do see in times when I turn to the Holy Spirit, I can have patience. Kindness. I've been described my whole life as a kind person, and I used to always think that I'm just a good guy or whatever, but no, that's Christ working in me. Goodness. God is always moving me toward being more of a good person. I was raised in a really frugal family, but I see God changing me to be more and more generous as I get older. Also, I have more and more of a desire to help people who need it and to serve others. One thing people usually describe me as is a faithful person. Again, like this is something I used to always think, well, I'm just really good at being loyal and stuff. And no, that's the Spirit working through me. Gentleness. I've always been a pretty gentle person, and I know that's kind of looked down on a little bit as a man, but I've always been a pretty gentle person. Self-control is a sign of God at work in a person, and this one honestly is one I struggle a lot with things like lust or eating or gossip. Even in the midst of these sins, if I'll just turn to God, I have the power to let it go. So that's pretty much my testimony. The Christian life is just full of battles every day. I think one of the things that Satan uses the most in my life is busyness, and that's like even like church and church functions. But if I turn to God every day and spend time in the Word and in prayer, I grow so much in my relationship with God, and that's where I am now. Just I'm continuing to trust in the Holy Spirit every day. So that's my basic testimony. I know it's been long, but if you want to stick around, I'm going to go into some categories I've compiled about why I believe. So I hope you'll stick around. Forgive me if I read this one because these are very, very wordy. So the longer that I'm a Christian, the more I start to see that all things, every little nuance of life really fit together with the Bible and the gospel message. I've come up with some categories of reasons I believe in God and Jesus, and I may add more as I think of them, but so far they're noetical, experiential, physical, historical, testamental, the Bible, and the failure of other belief systems. You can find more exhaustive categories like this in books like John Ankerberg's Ready with an Answer. But this, my intent here isn't to compile everything I could about Christianity. My intent is to show you the things that I have noticed just thinking about all this on my own. So I'll probably spend the rest of my life fleshing out these categories, but so here we go. The first category is noetical. This term is pretty new to me, but philosopher William James explains, noetic refers to states of insight in the depths of truth unplumbed by the discursive of intellect. They are illuminations, revelations, full of significance and importance, all inarticulate though they may remain, and as a rule they carry with them a curious sense of authority. So basically things that we can't measure scientifically, but we know and experience all the time, like love. So number one under noetic is, for me, a deep sense of purpose. I noticed this most in days like when I was younger and like I didn't have a full-time job. I didn't have a lot to do and I would watch like a whole day just go by. And I really started to realize, like, I was created for a lot more than to just watch this day go by. I also noticed that almost everybody I know is good at something, and that something can be applied to sharing the gospel with people or serving other people. This also really seems to fit in with Jesus's parable of the talents in Matthew 25. It's pretty clear that he's commending those in the story that do something with their talents. It's also interesting to note the etymology of the word talent. Number two under noetic is a deep inner sense of justice. I can't remember when it was that I started to realize every single movie or book or whatever, especially action movies and stuff, they all have like the archetypal hero, unsung hero that fights a bad guy and goes against all odds to defeat this bad guy or some kind of evil. So many of those stories are about vengeance, right? I, for one, get super amped when the guy whose whole family was murdered and his wife was raped or whatever goes and just exacts revenge on the bad guy, you know? But in our world, sometimes you'll see like what you think is the bad guy being portrayed as a good guy. And this got me to think, who is really right and wrong, and why should the good guy be who I think he should be? This makes me quite a bit hesitant to classify someone as the bad guy, especially when they are just as zealously painting me as the bad guy. Again, the Bible, speaking of God's wrath, fully addresses justice. Romans 12:19 says, "Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge. I will repay,' says the Lord." Number three under Noetic is love. What is love? The concept pervades almost all of our creative endeavors, and I doubt there's a single person who's ever lived who would deny this thing exists. Yet, you can't see it under a microscope. There's no chemical or sequence of proteins that makes it up. No firing of synapses really causes it. But the feeling I get when I think of my closest family and friends is proof to me of its existence, as much as being able to observe an apple by tasting it and feeling it and even hearing it. And then you read in the Bible in 1 John 4:8, God is love. And also, the most famous verse, John 3:16, God so loved the world that he sent his son to die for us. The fourth category under noetical is ontological. Admittedly, I've just barely been introduced to this concept, but it makes a lot of sense to me. I wrote a blog kind of dealing with this from the point of view of a being that's just come into existence and is trying to question its existence. It's called The Primary Question. I'll put the link in the description. All arguments and debates on origin aside, I feel it deep down that I owe my existence to something much higher than myself. And when I say higher, I don't mean like if you take the most intelligent person in the world and then multiply them to get this being. I mean like so much bigger than me that he transcends all existence. I like the quote from Tim Allen. He says, "I want a relationship with whoever built me. This is too much, too weird that it happened by accident." Number five under noetical is the soul. You really have to ask yourself, what is a soul? It starts with really trying to think about what makes a person who they are, what drives their personality. I've noticed that when I see a picture of a person before meeting them, I formulate kind of a guess on how they act, how they sound, even to whether they're a warm or a cold person. But this is almost always completely changed after meeting the person and continues to change as long as you know that person. My wife and I kind of noticed this, like when our first son was born, we had so much love for him. When the second boy came, we kind of noticed like I feel like I don't love him as much as our firstborn. And we realized it's because we didn't know the second born the way we knew the firstborn. And as our secondborn got older, we knew him more. We started to see our love catch up with our firstborn. So you see how the longer you know someone, the more of their uniqueness, their quirks, their little idiosyncrasies you start to see. Every little smile, every squeal, the way they walk, their fears, how they act in a crowd, and so on. Or have you seen the dead body of someone you loved? You really have to experience that to truly understand that feeling that your loved one is absent from that body. Doesn't it seem like the soul is far greater than the sum of its parts? Can't you feel that it transcends the chemicals and electricity that keep this earthly vehicle moving? The next category is experiential. I see so many underlying principles in this world and how they're explained by a biblical understanding of existence. Number one is fatherhood or parenthood in general. I saw this in my relationship to my parents, and now that I'm a father, I see so much about God's character makes sense in light of this. For example, when my oldest son was just beginning to walk, he would push around this little stroller thing, and I remember he would come up on like a shirt that would block him, and my first instinct was to pull it out of the way for him, and then I realized if I left it there, then he would learn how to steer around it, and he would learn better balance and everything. A light went off in my head about the bigger problems that we face in life and how God seems like he doesn't hear our prayers. God refers to himself a lot in scripture as our heavenly father. And while that's hard to understand for people who didn't have a good dad or were abused as kids, I had a really good father, and so this makes a lot of sense to me. Number two under experiential is selfishness leads to destruction. I think the older I get, the more I see that God built us to serve other people. And so the opposite, serving ourselves, only leads us away from chasing God. I've also noticed that every once in a while I get exactly what I want, and it just doesn't fill the void. And that kind of leads you to feeling depressed about life. Number three under experiential is Jesus and the Bible's commands lead to life. I think the older I get, the more I see when the Bible says something like, do not be drunk with wine, to strive for the opposite always leads to, like it says, debauchery and alcoholism and a myriad of other bad choices like vomiting and health issues. When Proverbs says, it's to one's glory to overlook an offense. You see that this in practice will steer you away from conflict. Number four under experiential is spiritual. This one's hard for me because even as a believer, I am kind of skeptical in this area. So many times though, I've prayed for things and I've received what I've prayed for. One night when I was living alone in an apartment, I was feeling really spiritually oppressed and all this stuff started happening. But when I called out, in Jesus' name, leave me alone, everything stopped. I'll put a link to that full story in my description. It's called Dark Apartment. Number five under experiential is my own powerlessness over my sin. As someone raised in church and who continues to this day, I can't point to a time when all I did was sin and then I found Jesus. For lifelong Christians, sin battles come and go. There's times when our walk with God is weak and we backslide, and then there's times when we turn to the Holy Spirit and experience victory over our sins. It's at times that when I've been pulled down by pornography or drinking or even stealing and breaking the law, that I realize how weak I am, especially the addictive sins. I realize that no matter how hard I try, I can't get control over them on my own. Recognizing how much of a sinner I am and how much my righteousness is like filthy rags, I realize I too am a sinner just like everyone else, and one day I'm going to stand before a holy, righteous God and tremble for what I've done. The next category is physical and scientific. This goes back to my interest in creation science books. For me, the observable world around me is much more attributable to a God than to random chance over time. There are countless aspects to science that point to God, but I'll just list a few here. Also, my favorite verse in the Bible, I think, is Romans 1:20. It says, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse." Number one under physical and scientific is God's fingerprints. George Washington Carver said, "I love to think of nature as an unlimited broadcasting station through which God speaks to us every hour if we'll only tune in." And when I really look at nature and think about it, it's like coming into a room and seeing a coffee cup steaming. You know someone has just been in that room. It's been said that God's fingerprints are on everything. I wrote a blog about this some years ago called Reveal Yourself, and I'll put a link in the description. For example, on really hot days when the sun's beating down on my head, I'm thankful to be able to seek shade. But then I've thought about like the tree giving me shade. Where is its shelter? And then I see how God's engineering is so much better than the roofs that we build that provide shade but are deteriorated by the sun's UV rays. The tree has a million little roofs all swaying in the wind, so none of them take too much direct sun for too long. And then at the end of the summer, they lose all those leaves and start over next year. Number two under scientific and physical is entropy. Way before I knew the second law of thermodynamics, which is in all energy exchanges, if no energy enters or leaves the system, the potential energy of the state will always be less than that of the initial state. I noticed that everything is always falling apart, breaking, running down, and it seems like everything needs some kind of maintenance to keep it up and keep it going. Most scientists agree that the universe is going to end in a heat death when everything becomes the same temperature. When I look at the world around me, I see everything winding down and falling apart, not evolving to a higher state. This seems to me to fit in with the Bible's account that everything was created good in the beginning and then sin broke the world.
So number three under physical and scientific is the transcendence of a maker over his creation.
Again, something I observe in real life all the time is that if there's a painting, there's a painter. If there's an engine, there's an engineer. If there's a building, there was an architect and there were constructors who built it. Any biologist or brain surgeon or neurosurgeon will tell you that the organic computer in our skulls is far, far more advanced than any computer ever built. Well, actually, Bill Gates said that. He said DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than any software ever created. So why is it hard to believe that whatever made me is as much beyond me as I am beyond a computer? Number four under physical and scientific is living metaphors. Something I've noticed in life, and I can't think of a better way to explain, is what I call a living metaphor, meaning actual situations and relationships in our life seem to explain God's reasons for things and his relationships to us like a metaphor. I mentioned one of these earlier in experiential as fatherhood. Another one is, take for example, a dog who has wandered in and gotten in a tangle with a porcupine, and he's got all these quills sticking out of his nose, and the master has to hold him down and pull out each quill. And the dog is struggling because he does not understand what's going on. He's like, why is my master doing this? It hurts so bad. But the master knows that if those are left in, they'll cause infections and lots more pain. Thinking about a situation like this suddenly makes me see a reason for just about any pain and suffering. God spells out everything we need to know through his word. As thick-headed as I am, though, I always have to see it in real life before it suddenly makes sense to me. The next category is historical. Number one is Christianity. Impact on the world. Secular society is always trying to erase or minimalize how Christianity shaped our world. But I keep coming across things that make me stop and wonder how, if this was a cult being perpetuated by weak-minded people, how did Christianity accomplish so much? For instance, the year that we still to this day identify ourselves in is based on the approximate birth of Jesus Christ. Time's divided between BC and AD. As I write this, it's 2019 years Anno Domini, which is the year of our Lord. I first heard in my art history classes, my professor was telling us they're trying to change BC to BCE before Common Era, and then AD to CE, Common Era, which is laughable revisionist history because you still have to wonder what caused the divide in the first place. Speaking of art history, this is where I gained my knowledge of art through the ages, and I was just in awe of how much classic work is dedicated to Christianity and specifically to Jesus. There's countless paintings of like Adam and Eve by Masaccio, but specifically the ones about Jesus like Leonardo da Vinci's The Last Supper. There are so many of those. I really cannot think of any religion, but specifically person, that has so much literature and art dedicated to them in the entire history of the known world. Two under historical is archaeology. Admittedly, I don't know a lot about this, but I do know they found scraps of the Bible throughout time, including the Dead Sea Scrolls, that showed translations for centuries have maintained the material impeccably. Also, archaeologists have found and continue to find evidences that only back up the historicity of the Bible. And lastly, under historical is etymology. Many words and phrases can be traced back to biblical roots. One time I was putting together a little talk about using our gifts for serving God, and I was basing it on the parable of the talents in Matthew 25. I'd always read scripture and knew that talent was some kind of money denomination of that time, but I didn't know, and I found this out, that actually the word that we use to be good at something can be traced back to this parable, talent. The next category is testamental. Obviously, you can't just believe something because somebody said it's true. In fact, atheists have come up with a little fake god called the Flying Spaghetti Monster to basically say, see, I made up this god and you have to worship it, and which is basically the argument of Russell's teapot, saying that the burden of proof lies upon someone making unfalsifiable claims. People who choose to stand on this reasoning seem to put God on the same level as the Flying Spaghetti Monster, the teapot in orbit. I think they're willfully ignoring the fact that no one actually believes in those things, and the evidences for God are far, far more abundant. In addition to all the things I've already listed, millions of people from every nation and time, all ages, sex, and race have wholeheartedly put their faith in God and in Christ. Again, this alone doesn't prove Christianity. The same can be said for a lot of false religions, but I've read, watched, and listened to the testimonies of countless people from the very wise and intelligent to the very average. I've seen the tearful and heartfelt stories being told from those who turned from atheism, New Age, witchcraft, Satanism, and so on. Christian doctors, professors, and scientists are plentiful. The stories of people like Billy Graham, Corey Ten Boom, Francis of Assisi, Richard Wurmbrand, who wrote Tortured for Christ, and on and on and on. I put a link below in the description of a playlist I put together called Testimony of a lot of these people's testimonies. You should check it out. Number one under testamental is missionaries. I've been on several short-term mission trips, and I've rubbed shoulders with people who have given up everything to reach people for Jesus. The YWAM teams that are making it possible for Homes of Hope to build houses in Mexico, the translators that we had in Uganda who knew the Bible better than I did, the Huber family who started Igreja de Paz in Brazil. They are just spreading all over, even down into Sao Paulo with Pastor Abe Huber, his brother and his wife in Tokyo at the Nobrito Ecclesia. Our translators in Haiti, Ray and Candace Ward's work and with the Outpour movement in Thailand, and so on and so on. Number two under testamental is unlikely converts. From the myriad of YouTube testimonies, like I mentioned, of people trying to disprove the Bible, to people like Alice Cooper and Brian Head Welch from Korn, it shows me that God's power reaches down to the most hard of hearts and transforms people. The book, The Secret Thoughts of an Unlikely Convert by Rosaria Butterfield, is a great example. Number three under testamental is martyrs. A martyr of any kind has to believe absolutely in what he dies for. So with the thousands upon thousands of Christian martyrs in history, they either had to be right or sufficiently brainwashed to be tortured in the most horrific ways imaginable. Many years ago, I read a book by DC Talk and Voice of the Martyrs called Jesus Freaks. Recently, I listened to the audiobook Fox's Book of Martyrs. I know people have been martyred for other beliefs, but the sheer number who have let go of their life at the hands of the most vile and vicious adversaries has to make you curious at what was so compelling to them. Number four under testamental is friends and family. The testament of my closest friends and family shows me how Christ has influenced and changed them. Their stories of faith build a foundation I can stand on. The trustworthiness of someone you know and love carries as much weight in what they say as the veracity of their claim. You may have one crazy religious uncle or even a branch of the family, but when generations pass the gospel down, you see the experience of the Christian life lived out in countless friends and family. It becomes apparent that what they believe has merit. The next category is biblical. The Bible is a mysterious book because although it was written over many years from different authors, it's consistent with its overall message and amazingly points to Jesus from thousands of years before he was born. It contains numerous prophecies that have been fulfilled. Its wisdom is unrivaled. I could go on and on about the Bible, but its central message of Christ being crucified and risen to bring us back to God is the most profound message ever claimed as truth. The character of Jesus is admired as
just about as much among non-Christians as it is among Christians. Philip Schaff once said, "It would take more than a Jesus to invent a Jesus." And this seems to be true to me. People have been able to create all kinds of heroes and superheroes through time, but no one who comes to culminate Jewish law, to be fully human and live a sinless life, God's son, but yet giving himself as a servant to all mankind, and on and on and on. If someone did sit down and write this character, he must himself be Jesus or God. Entire books have been written about the Bible and Jesus, and so I won't go on. Again, this is just my own astonishment at the Bible. Many people will say things like, "How can you trust a book written thousands of years ago by sheep herders?" Well, partly because this is just wrong, but also because I reject the idea of dismissing something just because it's old. In fact, something that survived millennia has to be protected by God and contains some rock-solid truth. Also, C.S. Lewis coined the phrase chronological snobbery, which he explains is the uncritical acceptance of the intellectual climate common to our own age, and the assumption that whatever has gone out of date is on that account discredited. And I find much of our society rejects Christianity on this basis. The next category is the failure of other belief systems. Who in the world has time to fully investigate every possible belief system and then make a judgment as to which is truth? It's easier to throw them all out or just give them a default equal ground. So, besides being born in a Christian home, how can I be comfortable choosing Christianity? I started a few years ago to compile a list of the things I think an ultimate worldview or belief should address, and that in my blog called The Theory of Everything. I'll put a link in the description below. I personally believe Christianity is the most sound, all-encompassing explanation of everything I see and experience in this world. Several other religions come close, but then they miss one of these things, usually in dealing with sin, and especially the sin I see in myself. If I were to sum up the religions of the world, I would say they're various practices to either help you become a better person, to reach God by your good works, become God yourself, or more or less realize that you are God. Christianity maintains that I am the creation and God is the creator who reached down and saved me by doing what I could not do on my own. So having shared all this with you, I would like to invite you into a relationship with Jesus Christ, your Redeemer, the one who saved you. So how to become a Christian? Many of evangelicals will pass out tracts with a concise prayer, usually called like the Sinner's Prayer, in which you will ask Jesus into your heart. And while I believe those are usually well-intentioned and indeed contain the correct scriptures for a prayer, I think it easily becomes a formula. I believe the very first step in becoming a Christian is to realize your sin before a holy and omnipotent God. This isn't really something you can rush. You have to contemplate and realize how lost you are before you really see the enormity of what Christ accomplished on the cross for you. And since this is all about a relationship with God, you need to confess to Him your sins and repent. These days, the word repent has become like Christianese, and even most Christians seem to think it simply means to be sorry. Repentance is the sorrow that comes from realizing that God's way is right and you are wrong, and then changing your beliefs to fall in line with God. The next step is to really put your faith in Christ's atoning sacrifice, and then believing His resurrection from the dead conquered death and paid the price for your sin, which would have been eternal separation from Him, also known as hell. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. The third step is acknowledging Him as Lord of your life and allowing Him to give you His Holy Spirit to guide and comfort you in all you do for the rest of your life. And that's it. There's nothing more. If you truly believe this, putting the Lord on the throne in your life will change you, and you'll begin to see the fruits of the Spirit. I urge you to profess this faith by publicly getting baptized. And then lastly, I'd just like to say, look down in the description below where I've provided a reading list of the books that really help shape my views on all of this stuff. So I know this is really long, so thank you for sticking in there. And if this has helped you in any way, leave comments below or contact me. Thanks, guys.